please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
I want to ask you even a more macro picture. I mean, do you see the market well supported at, you know, this 10,000, 10,100 mark? How are, in terms of flows, the mutual fund flows so far have been very good, and even February was better than January.
We actually have a slightly contrarian view out here. We think we are peaking out on the financial savings and equity flows in general. If you just look back at the past 12, 14 months since demonetization, there was a surge in mutual fund inflows. If you break up the flows, you realize that roughly about 60% of the flows came from non-SIP. It used to be 25% non-SIP and 75% SIP earlier. We believe that the, you know, the 3-time surge in inflows coupled with this mix changing is actually a one-off demon, black swan kind of event, which is not going to sustain. That's one. Second is there is a pattern to savings flows if you analyze it over the years. The best returning asset class across gold, property, bonds, equities, and even fixed deposits, the best returning asset class tends to see the fastest growth. Last year, equity was by far the best. While most others were single digits or negative, equity was mid-30s or thereabouts. So basically, you saw a deluge. And you also look at the character post-demon, the money cash getting converted into mutual fund flows, the likelihood of taxes likely to go up on that pool of capital had to be offset through higher returns. And the mindset of the investors was to take little more risk. That we think is not going to change, because we think in this calendar year 18, equities will not be the best returning asset class. It could be gold, it could be even fixed deposits faster, higher if rates go up, and we believe it will. So our assessment is we will not see mutual fund flows nowhere near where it was. In fact, it will keep moderating, and by the time the year ends, calendar year ends, we'll be well below where we were for the full year. That creates the flows and then the points that you said on how what's going to hold the market, because FII flows have not been anywhere close to how it was say 3 years back, and that's also going to be a bit of a valuations need to cool off for fresh flows, FII flows to come off. So there is a bit of a problem out here on flows front.
Okay. All right, Ganesh, we will leave it at that. Pleasure having you with us in the studio.
Thank you.
Okay, so markets at this point in time now beginning to show a little bit of red. A bit of it is because of Coal India going ex-dividend. I think you knock off 16 rupees, Anuj tells me. Yeah. It's 15 rupees down now.
Yes, but that of course 15 rupees, but that doesn't impact the Nifty calculation. It's, okay. The dividend is taken out when you are taking the move on the index. But overall, the Bank Nifty is down about 38 points and the Sensex is ending flat. The mid caps could once again do well if the Nifty is holding the range, the mid advance decline at about 2:1 for now. Ashwani, quick thoughts on how the pre-open settled and your top call for the morning?
So it's not something that you want to take an immediate trade on, because hardly 10-15 points. The place to trade is obviously either at the lower end or at around yesterday's highs, maybe 10,400 thereabouts at best. 914 call, I think you would go with the Mindtree, which is a buy with a stop of 838, target of 860.
Okay, Mindtree. In fact, a lot of the mid-cap IT names have been doing very well. They've been the big gainers this week. In terms of gainers, JP Associates is up about 8%, but remember, it's still a 20 rupee stock, so the base is pretty low there. You have a couple of others, the Amtech Group companies, Castex Technology is also moving up just a tad bit. A lot of small cap stocks really are moving up, so keep an eye out on that. Alok Industries, etc., Videocon, all of these really, really small cap stocks are moving up quite a bit right now. But let's give you a quick programming note. Remember, Network 18 brings to you its marquee thought leadership initiative. The Rising India Summit starts today at 5 p.m. and it is a show that you just cannot afford to miss. The event will be graced with national and international luminaries from the fields of governance, arts, business and academia, all under one roof. India's Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi, Union Home Minister Rajnath Singh, Road and Transport Minister Nitin Gadkari, Defence Minister Nirmala Sitharaman, Commerce Minister Suresh Prabhu, Finance Secretary Hasmukh Adia, Finance Commission Chairman N.K. Singh and Niti Aayog CEO Amitabh Kant will be speaking amongst other bureaucrats and ministers, while notable Nobel laureate Paul Krugman will be the event's keynote speaker. One of the biggest global market voices, Ruchi Sharma of Morgan Stanley, will also be present.
Notable personalities from corporate India, such as Anil Agarwal of Vedanta, SBI Chairman, Rajneesh Kumar, Nestle, Suresh Narayan, Yes Bank's Rana Kapoor, Chairman of Maruti, R.C. Bhargav, Axis Bank's Shikha Sharma, Adani Group's Gautam Adani, and Make My Trips' Deep Kalra are some of the icons from India Inc. who will be gracing the occasion. Private equity champion, if you please, Sanjay Nair of KKR, and market veteran Madhu K. Lau will also be giving their views on the India Growth story. Stay tuned to India's number one business channel, CNBC TV18, for live coverage of this mega initiative. All right, so markets actually settling in absolutely flat terrain. 0.15 down on the Nifty, nothing at all on the Sensex, static at yesterday's closing levels. Mid-caps are a shade higher. Mr. Tulsian, finally, I wanted to ask you, there's lots of news coming in on Auro Pharma. Is that a stock that you would continue to buy?
See, we have always been liking this stock. Yes. I don't know, maybe the stock has not moved or has not been moving up in this last 6 or 8 months. But if you see maybe in terms of fundamentals, in terms of financial performance, in terms of the US FDA regulations, they have been keep receiving the regular US FDA clearances also. Their ANDA pipeline is quite strong. EPS is, if you really see, maybe for FY19, I won't be surprised to see it 50. So ruling at a P multiple of maybe 13, 14 or 12, 13. So taking all this into consideration, we have been, in fact, this is one of our top pick, though we have not been very compulsive buyers in the pharma space, but we have been giving buy call on three stocks, that is Auro Pharma, Divi's Lab and Glenmark, in the same pecking order. So we continue to like Auro Pharma and we continue to have a positive view.
Okay. Ms. Tulsian, also wanted your quick thoughts on how one should approach JP Associates. Now, of course, you've spoken about that in great detail over the past few days. But, when you see large investors investing in the stock, a lot of people do coattail investing, retail investors, and then they get trapped at higher levels. At this level of 20 rupees, what would your call be?
No, if someone feels that he got trapped, by tracking the large investors, because large investors will definitely be entering and exiting very swiftly, because they enter with some news flows and, they exit also. That's how the stock also comes down. But I have been on a pure fundamental basis and taking a specific call on GP Associates. I have been saying that once, because if you really take the situation now, JP Infratech and JP Power is already a SDR case where the lenders have invoked their 51% and the ownership lies with them. So that is already seen as ceased to be a subsidiary or company of JP Associates. Same fate may happen with JP Infra, and once those things will happen, you will see the reduction in the consolidated debt of JP Associates at least by 20,000 crore with a standalone debt of closure to about 5,000 crore. And in fact, for the last couple of days also, I've said that on the standalone basis, if you take a call on JP Associates, taking all their valuations, maybe cement plant, EPC business, hotel, hospitals, land, sports complex and all sort of things, the valuation comes to anywhere about 16 to 18,000 crores. So in fact, I have been seeing quite positive. In fact, same view holds for JP Infra also, maybe on the new promoter coming in, but similar view is seen more positive even on JP Associates also, with the same promoter continue to remain with a liability of just 5-6,000 crore. Once all this resolution process happens, both these companies get ceased to be as the subsidiary of JP Associates. So I see huge value existing in JP Associates, but for that you have to have a timeline of maybe about 4 to 6 months to reach benefits out of the investments.
Yeah, out of all these court cases. Point taken. Thank you very much, Mr. Tulsian, for joining us. We just have about half a minute now for the markets to open, and it appears at the moment, at least pre-market is not giving you a clear direction at all. Of course, our experts technical experts also have been telling us that it's likely to be an extremely rangy day. Let's see whether even that initial SGX Nifty indicated gap down is not showing up, at least in the pre-market. We'll have to wait and see how things pan out. It's only Nifty Bank which is showing a little bit of red on the screen, 38 points down.